1977, around the world in 365 days. In July 1977, a glider pilot named Bill Flewellen decides to challenge Japan's Mount Fuji, daring the heat of the turbulent air currents in his flimsy craft. And he makes it. It's an easy trip. And he glides over the housetops, touching down to a hero's welcome. Another win for man in that endless game of conquering the natural world. The French and the British got the Concorde flying in 1976, but environmental protests delay landing at Kennedy International until October 19, 1977. This first landing is either 3 minutes ahead of schedule or 20 months late, depending on how you look at it. Gary Gilmore, convicted of murder, wants to die, but there have been no executions in the States for 10 years. A poll shows most people think Gilmore should get his wish. On January 17th, it happens. Very nice. But for Canada's First Lady, I make that ex-First Lady. The fabled storybook romance plays out as near farce. Bert Lance, the first to be appointed to Jimmy Carter's cabinet, becomes the first to leave. He resigns because of alleged improprieties. Hound dog Elvis Presley is no more. He sold more records than anyone, inspired the shape of pop music, and stirred the hearts of young ladies and old. A funeral fit for the king of rock and roll. Another loss, the quipmaster of You Bet Your Life, Groucho, the last of the Marx Brothers. Comedy's grief is doubled with the death of Charlie Chaplin. The Little Tramp's way of getting into scrapes with everyone endeared him to all and brought him belated honors for the wit and humanity that lives still on film. More Hollywood heartache, the loss of crooner Bing Crosby after 50 years in show business. Bing must travel his new road alone. Fifteen years after the Cuban Missile Crisis, they're playing the Star-Spangled Banner in Havana. A basketball team with players from two South Dakota universities goes to Cuba. It's part of a 90-member delegation that hopes to talk to Castro about more serious matters. Fidel is away, visiting friends in Russia and Africa. So Brother Raul chats with the visitors. It's a hard-fought match. The Cubans win the game, but the Americans are thrilled anyway.
Well, when I heard that national anthem, it was really touching. You know, it was something that really hits your old heart and really makes you think, because here's the national anthem being played in Cuba, and after you've heard, you know, and the trouble we've had in the past, and to hear the national anthem down here, it really made us feel good to be a part of it, to be the first sport team down here in 16 years. That was really super.
There's no reason under the sun why Cuba and the United States shouldn't be getting along with each other, trading with each other, talking with each other, exchanging people, students, and ideas, and I think that day will come.
I just felt, you know, God, I don't believe this. You know, I don't understand why we're here. I can't, you know, it's just something I never expected.
Indira Gandhi's troubles began in 1972 with drought and famine, then the oil embargo. In 1975, she declared a state of emergency. Others called it dictatorship. She schedules an election and releases the opposition leader she has jailed. Nehru's daughter, at 59, is in her 11th year as prime minister. Four opponents forge a coalition, and they win a landslide victory over her Congress party. Some 200 million voters go to the polls. The new prime minister is Morarji Desai, 81, once a deputy of Mrs. Gandhi's. All India rejoices as the state of emergency is lifted. In October, Gandhi is taken into custody on charges of financial corruption, but released after one day. Look who's come calling on Israel's Prime Minister, Menachem Begin. It's the President of Egypt, Anwar Sadat. The people of Jerusalem can hardly believe what they see. The leader of an enemy they have fought for 30 years through three major wars. It's a momentous event. Press from all over the world. Here to record history in the making.
We drove President Sadat and I several times together. We have seen our people on the streets, in the thousands, men, women, and little children. And all of them greeting the president, taking him to their hearts. Our children waved both flags, the Egyptian flag and the Israeli flag. I wish, with your permission, Mr. President, to express my sincere hope that the day is not too far when Egyptian children will wave the Israeli flag and the Egyptian flag.
It's the year of Queen Elizabeth's Silver Jubilee, celebrating the quarter of a century since her reign began. She's presided over the rocky days of economic crisis, the decline of a superpower that had been a major force in world affairs since the time of her forebear, Elizabeth I. Married at 21 to Prince Philip, she was 26 when she assumed the throne in 1952. It seems like only yesterday. Elizabeth, on her way to the coronation at Westminster Abbey. She's the queen to people in 10 nations, and she heads the 36 Commonwealth nations as well. It costs $15 million a year to keep the queen and her royal kin, a bit less than the government spends on tranquilizers dispensed through socialized medicine. But it does seem to keep them just as happy. Lord Hume.
Well, the Queen obviously has a constitutional role of great importance, really, because after all, everything is done in the name of the Queen. All legislation is passed in the name of the Queen, Queen and Parliament, and so they're one. She puts public service above everything, and far above, of course, politics, in which she does not herself intervene. I think she is influential, not that she would take a political part. It is influence. It isn't so much power now.
Having lived through the last war and having seen what's happened throughout Europe, Latin America, the Middle East, everywhere else, I've come to the conclusion that the monarchy, the monarchical system for our country is certainly the best.
I think they're fantastic. I think they do a very good job. I think they work very hard.
She's head of the army. She's the chief of the judiciary. So there is on paper and formally a very important position for the Queen.
Well, I think it's part of the British heritage and rather a monarchy than a dictatorship.
Special coins, fireworks, good old England.
For years and years, people have said, good old England, we fought two world wars, we won them. You know what I mean? So England, it's England's all about glory. Fine old England, Lionheart and all that. Well, that's crap, you know.
The editor of Sniff and Glue magazine.
There isn't any future for a kid now. I mean, there isn't, you know?
Sex Pistols singer, Johnny Rotten.
God save the Queen! Fascist regime! It made you a moron! Potential H-bomb! God save the Queen! She's not a human being! There is no future!
Save the Queen!
the only future for a kid now is if they're lucky to get a sort of secure job. They'll either go in a sort of job like that, insurance or the bank, or they're on the dole. Or otherwise they're brickies and labourers and sort of dumb-edging and they'll never get anywhere. A lot of people are opening up their eyes and finding out that all we've got is the past. We've got no future, you know?
The manager of the Sex Pistols, Malcolm McLaren.
Teenage kids who follow punk rock in this country, in their style and form of dress is a total reaction against the packaging of youth clothing in this country. They are really concerned now with taking any form of clothing and making a statement with it by tearing it up, writing a slogan across it that suggests something of their own particular discontent.
How'd you do that?
Well, my mate done it for me with a needle.
Oh yeah? Does it hurt though?
It's not what it did when he done it, 3 weeks ago.
What?
But it's not quite right. It's almost through now, but it's sore when he done it about 3 weeks ago.
You've got to get out there and shove it down people's throats, your ideas.
The Sex Pistols are the punkest of the punk lot. Their excesses catch up with them after a time, but their version of God Save the Queen is a big-selling record. Their appeal is to the young, to those titillated by the bleeping of the Pistols' comments on the telly.
You dirty old man.
Well, keep going, Chief, keep going. No, no, what was the rude word?
Shit.
Was it really? Good heavens, you frightened me to death.
Oh, all right. See,
what about you girls behind?
That's like your dad, isn't he, Skeeter?
Go on, you've got another 5 seconds. Say something outrageous.
You dirty bastard.
Go on, again.
You dirty
What a clever boy.
What a rotter.
Well, that's it for tonight. The other rocker, Abel, and I'm saying nothing else about him, will be back tomorrow. I'll be seeing you soon. I hope I'm not seeing you again. From me, though, good night.
I'm going to complain to ITV.
Many fear that the punk's mock frenzy will turn into real violence.
Violence is becoming more and more prevalent in gigs. You'll probably see it tonight. There'll be a group of people who constantly just spit at the band. Just spit, 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 spit. And that's very fashionable at the moment, and that's okay. You can take being spat on, you know, in as much. But there are others then who'll actually attack members of the audience and attack the band.
If it means being a bit violent, you know, so okay, you know.
Some idiots think that it's necessary to actually adopt a violent attitude towards the other people who go to gigs or towards people who dress differently. I mean, we had it the other week in the Music Machine where a guy came up on stage and smashed me in the face, and some of his mates threw pint glasses onto the kids who were dancing on the floor. Now that's becoming, with some crowd of them, a fashion, and it's the most obscene aspect of the new wave. And I think they are sort of such a low standard of intelligence that they have misinterpreted the natural feeling they should get from the thing. They don't have to rationalize the new wave, you just have to feel it.
You know, the message is honesty, you know, being on the same level as the kids in the audience.
It's punk rock, then punk fashion, then punk protest. But it's all punk. If the future belongs to the young, these kids don't like the look of it. They find traveling in gangs makes life more tolerable, much like the street gangs of New York. California psychologist Rollo May sees it this way.
The gangs in New York City that I know most about are made up of young people who have no hope, no jobs, no possibility of getting jobs. They simply are filled with boredom day after day. They gather then in gangs in order to express some sense against the society that we are persons like everybody else, and why is it that our society has left us out? No person can exist without his own sense of significance, and if he can't get it one way, then he will get it through shooting somebody on the street or through Walter Mitty fantasies that may eventually end up in some kind of psychosis or in some other way. It's absolutely essential that he get over his feeling that he's a nobody and that he has some feeling that he has some potency and some significance.
If young people in the Western world feel life is hopeless, what of the others? The Queen and tranquilizers do the trick in England. In India, they use films. More movie footage is produced here than in any other country. Not the best quality, perhaps, but it serves a purpose, says Indian superstar Zina Aman.
I think that the commercial films that we make in this country are not for the intelligent thinking people who want to be stimulated. They are for the man in the street who leads a drab, dreary life and wants to get away from his everyday boredom and routine, and who wants to be entertained, who wants fantasies, who wants to get out of himself and, you know, out of his normality. So Indian films are made for these people.
Hi, Mommy. Hello, Papa.
Hello, sweetheart.
Knock at the door, knock.
Sweetie, ये तुम्हारी cousin है, दिल्ली से आई है.
I'm Sweetie.
I'm Pinky.
Sweetie बेटे, Pinky को बैठने दो यहाँ, मेरे पास.
देख दिखाओ, बारह साल को.
Any hint of sex is forbidden in Indian films, and that leaves maudlin love and excessive violence. The violence, of course, is not peculiarly Indian.
This is Bloody Mama, the incredible saga of Ma Barker and her boys, the most bloodthirsty killers in the history of crime.
What films and television do after you've seen about 1,000 films of violence or...
Dr. Daniel Kappen.
...is that the whole group fantasy of violence gets lit up in the head. And so a compulsion begins whereby everybody wants to get into the act and become violent.
If you want to see Shab score, you gotta ask your mama again.
Even better than movies and television for getting into the act is your local pinball parlor. It provides an endless variety of methods for a little synthetic killing. It's all harmless fun, says the Californian who devised Death Race. In Los Angeles, Paul Jacobs.
Death Race really is fantasy, and nothing more than that. And we don't try to depict anything that really happens in real life. Well, first of all, just a new twist into the game. We took the cabinet, painted it black, and tried to project skeletons or gremlins running across the graveyard. And what happened now is when you drove your automobile, you ran into a skeleton. He emitted somewhat of a shriek, turned into a grave marker, and that's how we changed the game, and the sales went up quite a bit.
Right, it's not a Volkswagen, it's not a Christmas tree, right? It's a human being. Is it harmful? To the extent that it again sanctions practice, training, learning how to hurt, kill other people, it sets the stage for when people are instigated to aggression to use those skills that they have.
If you drive L.A. traffic, and I'm a deliverer myself, you know, you get tired of pedestrians, and these little things, you know, kind of remind me of pedestrians. Spooks. You're supposed to run over the spooks and make the tombstones. They got little people running around. The object of the game is to run them over. I mean, that's a little sick, but it's fun.
These are not pedestrians. These are gremlins.
Kind of like hitting people, but kind of not.
Gremlins? Because they're not real. I wouldn't want to run over anybody.
They're just little... ghosts, I don't know. Just little people running around.
Whether or not those running, dodging robots are meant to represent people, it is agreed that they are turned into tombstones, and they do shriek when the hard-driving operator scores a bullseye. Got him. Got him.
When real violence happens, for instance, on the streets or on the road with an accident, you look at the blood and look at the disfigured body and you don't believe it, because your senses have been dissociated. Because when you see it on television, you just see it two-dimensionally and you hear it, but you don't really believe it. So the whole thing has a total air of unreality about it, and the consequences of violence are simply not believed.
People who never have had any sense of being persons themselves, never had any sense of potency, get off the track and become destructive. But we have to understand their destructiveness if we are to be able to help them or our society.
One who got off the track is a killer who signs himself Son of Sam, a misfit named David Berkowitz. He kills 6, wounds 7. He's an ex-army sharpshooter who says he gets messages from someone who lived in 4000 BC.
Ballistics section has just called and told us that the 44 caliber gun recovered tonight has been tested and the bullets match the bullets recovered from Stacy Moskowitz.
I'm very pleased to announce that the people of the city of New York can rest easy this morning because of the fact that the police have captured a man whom they believe to be the Son of Sam.
It is Berkowitz's car that leads police to him. It was ticketed for being parked by a fire hydrant on the night of the most recent murder, just a few blocks from the scene of the crime. Following the ticket lead, police find the car in Yonkers and find inside an envelope addressed in the killer's handwriting and a rifle.
He was apprehended. He was advised of his rights.
And he resisted.
Advised that he was under arrest, advised of his rights. No, he was resigned to what appeared to be his fate.
Did he make any admissions?
He made a statement along, well, you got me.
The police examination of Sam's gun and of his apartment seems only to verify the obvious. Another nut loose in society. There's nothing to explain his penchant for young, attractive women victims. No comfort to those victims or to their families. David Berkowitz, now at Attica, sentenced to 13 consecutive terms of 25 years to life. Sunday school teacher Anita Bryant leads a campaign that forces repeal of a homosexual rights law in Dade County, Florida. Despite Anita's campaign, more and more homosexuals come out of the closet. And just such a story is the basis of the movie Outrageous, produced by Bill Marshall and Hank Vanderkolk.
Diamonds are a girl's best friend. A kiss may be grand, but it won't pay the rent on your humble flat or help you at the bottom yet. You know, we've been singing that song for 25 years now, and it's almost perfect.
Craig Russell plays the hero, or is it heroine, of a movie about a homosexual who becomes a star as a female impersonator.
We're opening at the Owensboro Drive-In Dinner Theater. Recently, I attended a cattle call audition in New York City, and they were auditioning girls, you see, to find out who'd be my replacement as Lorelei Lee. Well, some of the greatest people showed up, and my favorite of all was Marlene Dietrich. Trick.
But when God or handshake is wrong, don't lose their shape. Diamonds are a girl's best friend.
I don't think this song is right for me. Smash his camera.
Hi, Ethel Merman here. I just love tunes. I'll sing them all. I hope you like the lyrics, because you're sure gonna hear them.
Ah!
Diamonds may be a guy's best friend, too. Emperor Jean-Bédel Bokassa's new crown has a 138-carat gem from the mines in his Central African Empire. The Empress, 28-year-old Catherine, the youngest of his three wives, joins the Emperor in a $25 million coronation. The Pope, royalty, and other important persons decline his invitation, but still, 3,500 guests show up. Bokassa, 56, is a former French soldier who survived the debacle at Dien Bien Phu and retired as a captain. His hero is another self-appointed emperor, Napoleon Bonaparte, with whom he shares many aspirations, though the similarity seems to end there. Bokassa's son and heir, who has the same name, Jean-Bédel, is resplendent in his navy whites, but bored. Daddy's always throwing some kind of party or another. Fashioned by Paris jeweler Arthus Bertrand, the royal crown is topped with that 138-carat diamond. The crown cost $2 million. And when he finally gets that old gold one off, he gives it to his son. In a land where even a visitor can be slapped in jail for little reason, it's not surprising that his crown-switching agility gets a round of applause. Only the crown prince is spontaneous.
Solennellement, devant le peuple, devant l'humanité tout entière.
Catherine's crown is expensive, but the House of Lanvin charged $72,400 for her coronation robe. And the bill for the jewelry, Bokassa's crown and scepter and Catherine's crown, comes to $5 million. I hope Jean-Bédel Jr. doesn't irritate the emperor. Is the empress amused or concerned? Yes, pay attention. Ah, well. Bring on the food. French wines, caviar, steak, 240 tons of food and drink flown in for the event, with a ton and a half of fireworks. Baked in the cake, a dozen bashful doves. The Central African Empire is one of the poorest. Average income, $200 a year. East meets West on fashion's runway, as Japanese designers make their influence felt throughout the world, though it's obvious they've come at least halfway. One of the best is Kansai Yamamoto, an inspired traditionalist. He gets his ideas from the costume of judo, the geisha, and the geta, the Japanese sandal.
Japanese people can export motorcycle and Sony. It means a machine. But I really feel we have a lot of talent. We have to export like this.
Another designer, Iso Imiaki, studied design in Paris, returned home, and now has a multi-million dollar fashion house in Tokyo. His idea is to take the rigidity of tradition and adapt it. His designs are sold in Paris and in New York.
Fashion is a very personal adventure. And I hope that many people, more people try to be more free, more wild. I think it's great, it's now.
In the department stores, we can find mannequins. They have blonde hair and high nose and also very tall. And it's very funny because Japanese people are all black hair and not so big. The businessmen are almost of them gentlemen. and maybe they like blonde girl. So it's very bad.
The Japanese are not raised to really move and be free with their bodies. It's very easy to get that off a Western gal, to get real movement and real action. Because all the Japanese are exactly the same. They're all dark. They're all the same. That's why a lot of foreigners are really like blonde hair. What else stands out more in Japan? Blonde hair and blue eyes or green eyes.
The world may now be buying Japanese fashion, but Tokyo streets have bought a lot of Americana. The elite art world is losing ground to this, schlock art. It has no status, but it's cheap, it's colorful, and it must be contagious because business is booming.
Can you tell us what kind of painting you're looking for?
Spanish. Anything in a Spanish painting.
Why is that?
All my furniture is Spanish.
I can paint a painting like this in about a half an hour. I always was a little faster at painting than the other people in my classes, but when I came to work here, I just learned to paint fast by painting fast. I'd like to paint my own stuff. I think most people would, but that's a good way to starve. And this is a good way to make money.
Is it a ripoff?
We never, ever discuss investment potential with any oil paintings that we sell. We're not selling paintings for $500 or $600 or $700 where we have to give people $400 worth of hope. And the average price is $20, $30, $40, $50, $60. At those prices, there's really nothing you have to talk about. You like it, you're gonna enjoy it, you have a place to hang it, you have the $30, $40, or $50, buy it and enjoy it.
I'm looking for a scene painting. Painting with a scene in it, you know, not as opposed to flowers or something of that nature.
South Moluccan terrorists seize a train, take 55 hostages, and a school with 110 pupils and teachers. The Dutch government refuses to negotiate. The South Moluccans demand to be heard. 40,000 of them in the Netherlands since their native islands became part of Indonesia. In 1951, the Moluccans chose the wrong side. Now they want the Dutch to help regain the homeland. Raids on the two hostage sites hit simultaneously. Dead, two hostages, six terrorists. 10 are wounded. The other hostages rejoin their families, but there is no resolution of the problem. A Moluccan says it was all a mistake.
What we, of our friends, have done in the actions is they have weapons, but they don't use it. They didn't want to kill anybody. They used weapons only to press, not for killing.
Seven terrorists get prison terms, 6 to 9 years. The hostility towards the South Moluccans in Holland becomes even more bitter. Another of those problems involving a small part of the globe, yet there seems no solution. The big problems, though not enough people seem concerned, may be easier. The energy crisis has been building for decades. Franklin Roosevelt warned that natural resources are not inexhaustible. Despite the growing shortage, planes fly and cars roll on. Polls show that less than 40% of the people consider the energy crisis real. We fill up our gas-guzzling cars. We air condition our skyscrapers. Then the government steps in with a heavy-duty energy policy. And scientists step up research into the fuels of the future. Nuclear energy is good, but it's controversial. The big nuclear accident of the decade hasn't happened yet, but environmentalists accurately predict it's only a matter of time. The world's largest consumer of energy must seek other ways to become less dependent on OPEC oil. It's time to test everything as a potential energy source. Anyone who's watched the ocean can see its dynamic strength. Its waves are violent and forceful. Its tides are powerful and dependable. Near St. Malo, France, this bridge crosses the Rance River estuary. Underneath, a success story that's being examined by energy-conscious countries. In a 1,200-foot hollow section below the water is a power station. This is the only large tidal hydroelectric plant in the world. Tides move twice a day, unaffected by inflation or politics. Another energy source, the radiant sun, is being tapped for its potential. Solar energy is costly and experimental, but it is a promising alternative. This large concave mirror is 12 stories high. When these solar panels reflect the sun onto the big mirror, temperatures at the focal point can reach 6,800 degrees, enough heat to melt a 1-inch steel armor plate in 30 seconds. The scientists are working faster now. Oil and time are running out. Energy makes our cities go or stop. When lightning strikes in 1977, New York is paralyzed. No lights, no trains.
We got $20 and we've got
personal checks.
$20 and a lot of personal checks. And what we're trying to do is figure out if we can talk these gentlemen into taking a personal check on our indubitable character.
We found one nice driver so far. It looks as if he might take a check if we can find one more person who has to go to New Haven.
If you could turn the camera to that nice driver. Where is
and
that?
Here he is right here.
He is right here.
Smiling for all
he
of us.
He might take a personal check for us how to get to New Haven.
If we can find one more person to go to New Haven.
Yes, that's another thing we
need. What
are
you going to do if you can't?
If we can't, we're going to wait here and use our train tickets. Last we heard, it's going to be about 11 o'clock tomorrow or something. So.
Police department has indicated.
Mayor Abe Beam.
That there is some sporadic looting. Queens, Manhattan, the West Side, Uptown, and Brooklyn South, Williamsburg, Broadway area, but there have been numerous arrests which have been made.
Those numerous arrests number almost 4,000. 1,500 cops are injured. 2 thieves are killed. It took about 6 minutes for the looting to start. One youngster said, "It's like Christmas in July." More than 2,000 stores are looted, an estimated $1 billion in property losses. The sirens wail and all commerce stops. But in New York, who worries about a crisis?
Oh, my children are all right, and we're not at war, and we lose the lights will go off and come on again.
We knew exactly what it was, took a quick walk, and walked 15 flights into the hotel.
Well, I think we ordered another beer when that was about.
The lights went off.
Yeah, the lights went off.
I think it's important to break up the continuity of everyday life and make people kind of rethink some of the basics.
Maggie Trudeau, one woman who's rethinking the basics. Only 6 years after their secret wedding, Pierre gets the kids and a boost in the popularity polls. Maggie gets her freedom, something she talked about when she got out of the hospital.
I didn't feel sick. I just felt very, very weary and very emotionally tight. I needed help because I was really, at that time, reaching a kind of a crisis stage in my life when I was, after the election, the letdown after the election campaign, I found myself very thoughtful about what I, as a human being, could do in the next while at my husband's side. You know, not just, I didn't want to just be caught in the role of politician's wife, and I wanted to have a chance to think about things and to be away from the strains of household and children and just retreat. And it seemed that the best way I could do that, and with the help that I probably needed because I was crying a lot, was to seek medical help, and it was through just a family doctor that I got turned on to a psychiatrist. I think it was a very positive thing that I did. It seemed to really help me a lot.
When I call myself a flower child, I think of myself as someone who cares and who doesn't care about the unimportant things, doesn't put too much value on money and social status, although how can I say that when I'm the Prime Minister's wife, except that I didn't marry my husband to be the Prime Minister's wife. I long for the day when we will no longer be I no longer will be the Prime Minister's wife when I can just be Pierre's wife.
I'm trying to discover what kind of role I should take, what kind of work I should do in the next 4 years, whether I should just be mother, wife, whether I should reach out a bit.
I think I'm a good wife and I'm a good mother. I think I try hard to do my best, but what I've discovered is that I was beginning to believe that I had to be, and the strain was just too much because I get as angry as anybody. I'm as weak as anybody else. I have as many problems, you know, I have as anyone else, and you can't be perfect. You just can't be. You can't please everybody, so you might as well please yourself.
I just really like to go out dancing at, you know, or go out and have a pizza, or just go out and drive around in the rain at 2 in the morning.
Driving around? At Toronto's El Macambo, Maggie celebrates her wedding anniversary without Pierre. While he minds the kids, the flower child wife of the Prime Minister is partying with her favorite rock band, the Rolling Stones. Maggie gathers no moss, and the gossips have a field day. She's off to launch a new career. Her chief asset?
Well, I think that mainly it's because of her name. I certainly wouldn't hire her as a photographer if she didn't have some, you know, capability of shooting pictures. The picture of Yasmin is very nice. I mean, it's an original sort of approach to a portrait in New York. We've done hundreds of stories here on celebrities in New York, and no one's ever done anything quite like that. She seemed to relate to the people, get them to do sort of, I mean, he's obviously having fun with her.
Do you think she can make it?
Well,
you're a veteran Life magazine photographer of some repute. Do you
well,
think?
Well, yeah. That? Well, I'll tell you, it just depends on her attitude, on whether or not she wants to make it. Yes, I think her photographs are pretty good. I mean, these are not real amateur pictures. They're pretty good pictures.
And what does Maggie think?
No, I think I'm a pretty lucky chick.
I, Jimmy Carter, do solemnly swear
that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
The office of President of the United States.
And will.
It was indeed a year of change for first families.
Preserve,
protect, and defend
the Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
I will walk the straight and narrow path, Senator, between what's right and what's wrong. And I'll do the best I can to measure up to the qualities of these other leaders in this auditorium.
Carter, the new political broom at the White House, tries to sweep away the bad memories. In 77, Agnew's still paying his tax debts. Nixon's still saying that if the president does it, it's not a crime. Kissinger's record is clean. He's moving on to teach university students. He passes on a few tips as he leaves.
Can I tell you, I don't draw a crowd like this anymore.
The new Secretary of State, to fill Kissinger's shoes, is Cyrus Vance.
Mr. Vance, you also saw former Secretary Rush this morning. Is there any thought of bringing him into your administration?
No.
It's been 5 years since the break-in. Nixon's Watergate boys have scattered far and wide. Some are writing books, bestsellers no less. One now edits a magazine. Some are in jail still in 1977. How will Carter's boys make out?
Oh, give me something to remember you by when you are far away from me. Some little something meaning love cannot die, no matter where you chance to be. Though I pray for you night
We'll drink to that. 1977. Thanks for the memories.